Well, that's what Australian police will be using. And now for a look at the other technology and gadgets that will be popular in the new year, we're joined to look ahead at tech in 2015 with futurist and author Mark Pesci from the University of Sydney. Mark, always a pleasure to chat.
Good to see you.
I hope this segment can run at least an hour and a half. Now, one of the big things, of course, is little Fitbit things, little watches, little gadgets.
Yes.
What's going to be on the cards for next year in terms of what will be on our wrists?
Everyone is waiting for the Apple Watch. Apple probably most of all, because more than probably any other product they've ever done, the Apple Watch is a blank slate. They haven't really said, other than it'll have a watch face and it can tie into your phone, what it's good at, because in a lot of ways, we don't know yet. It was sort of like the first version of the iPhone. You could make calls on it, you could get text messages, but it wasn't really the thing we think of today as a smartphone with all of these apps. It took time for people to grow into, what can you use this for? And in a lot of ways, the Apple Watch is going to be a conversation with the entire community of people about what can these devices do? How can they improve our lives? If it's going to be about putting email on your wrist, most people are not going to want to be interested in that, because most people are now starting to feel like we actually are maybe a little too well informed a lot of the time, and we're trying to find a boundary which allows us to sort of keep that stuff in hand.
That was actually one of the things I really wanted to talk to you about, Mark, was there has been this movement sort of away from being connected all the time. You've got kind of computer geeks trying to find those original phones with no internet connections where they can just text and call. You've got people deleting their Facebook accounts. How do you make technology keep innovating, say with Apple, but make something more human? And it's really about connecting you to the real world now as opposed to a virtual world.
There is a real movement. It's a bottom-up movement now among designers and technologists to remember about empathy, to remember that there are people using these things. And so we are, I think you're going to see over the next couple of years, the products that are the most empathetic are the ones that will succeed, because they're the ones that people will want to have a relationship with, not just with the device, but to have that relationship then through to other people, because these devices are connected. And so really what we had to do is, I think, maybe bring ourselves right to the edge and take a look down. It's like, no, we don't want to go there. Let's step back and now think about how these devices, which are now everywhere, can affect our lives.
You have a prop. We love props. Tell us what this is about. I can see you've got a smartphone in a little cardboard box. I could do that at home. Could I do this at home?
Pretty much. This is called Google Cardboard. So Google has an annual developer event in June, and they took this, basically it's a cardboard case. There's a smartphone sitting inside the case. There are two lenses here, and it turns your smartphone into a virtual reality headset. Now, a virtual reality headset would normally cost $1,000. Shane Warne was showing one off on the Cricket the other day. This costs, in components, you can buy it from China for about $3. Because all of the brains are in your smartphones. You pop your smartphone in and you can take a look around. Earlier, I took a 3D panoramic photograph of the ABC lobby here in Ultimo. I'm actually doing that, but I could be taking a look around Versailles or any other place that I wanted to visit. You will probably see over the next, maybe not next year, but 2016, 2017, live broadcasting. So imagine being at a sports event and being able to look around. It's also going to change news coverage, because you'll be in the middle of a war zone. It's going to be quite frightening, but it's going to make it very real.
Do people want things to be that real?
Not all the time. And again, this is about finding where you want things to be real. There are news junkies who will want that kind of adrenaline rush, but probably it's going to be someone who's a cricket tragic who wants to be right there in the MCG.
I'm getting one. I want to be there. We've heard a lot, Mark. There's so many things I want to talk to you about. We've heard a lot about drones. There was an article out the other day about danger of all these drones being popped under Christmas trees, and we still haven't figured out flight airspace rules and privacy things.
Right.
Where's all this going to be going in 2015?
So on Monday, CASA released a whole set of regulations about hobbyist drones, so people who aren't flight certified, because CASA would normally ask people to have a pilot, more or less a pilot license to pilot a drone. But there's a lot of drones out there that just people got. They're a couple $100. They're really lovely. They're a lot of fun to play with. But they've now said, okay, here's the set of rules. You have to be 5 kilometers away from an airport. You can't operate it above a certain height, because the biggest thing is you don't want it flying into a jet engine, right? You don't want to do anything that could interfere with normal traffic. But on the other hand, a drone was being flown at a site in Queensland, I think last week. It fell out of the sky and it hit a policeman. So you also have to take into account you aren't allowed to fly over crowds of people. You know, you have to stay well away. So there's all of these rules that really are common sense, but now they're establishing a framework. So probably what we're going to see is that while you won't necessarily have a drone pilot license, there will be an expectation that if you're using a drone, you or whoever is supervising you are familiar with the correct rules for using that drone.
And I guess one of the things will be enforcing those rules and also educating people about those rules instead of jumping onto, say, the CASA website. Very interesting. Now, of course, while you're driving your new helicopter with your virtual glasses on at the MCG, because you're really, you know, in Darwin, you could also be not doing anything like driving a car because it's self-driving, according to Google.
That's right. So Google has been, of course, working on the self-driving car for a number of years now. They trotted out the final model about 2 weeks ago. It is going to be street legal in California starting early next year. The one thing that the California legislature required of them was that it has to have full controls. The only thing it had in the first version was a start and stop button. And frankly, it made the legislators a little bit nervous because what happens if the robot loses power or goes crazy or whatever? And so there's going to be a steering wheel and all of the normal pedals in it, but normally you'll never have to touch them. And they're going to start testing these on the roads in California, generally for the city sorts of things. It generally doesn't go much faster than about 40 Ks. So it's meant for little commutes around the city. And you're going to start seeing hundreds of these in California and then across America next year.
Very exciting times, Mark. Always such a pleasure to speak with you. Thanks so much for dropping in tonight. I know you've postponed dinner plans to be here. So thank you so much, Mark.
Thank
See you,
Kumi.
Next year.
You too.